Oh, good times. Good times here on North Courts.
3, 2
You know it.
1
Hey everyone, thanks for joining North Courts. We've got an exciting episode for you today. Before we head to the line for 3, a couple weeks ago, we talked about Lugens Dort, and I specifically talked about Lugens Dort and the way he was playing. Lugens Dort is averaging 17 points, 5 boards, and 2 steals, really getting it done. He definitely stepped up to the plate, but some people took it personal, specifically Jamal Murray. He went and dropped 50 on 21 of 25 shooting. I mean, that is just ridiculous. Shout out Jamal, shout out the 519. Apologies on my behalf. We will make sure we talk about Jamal. But on that note, we are going to go to a bit of a negative side. The Nuggets played the Wizards, and it was one of the most bizarre finishes you'll ever see. They get the ball in transition, down 2. Jamal Murray has the ball. For some reason, you've got Michael Porter Jr. running to the three-point line. Facundo Campazzo running to the three-point line. Jamal Murray backs up to the 3 as well. They just need a 2. Now, the positive I will say is Jamal, after the game, tweeted out, taking ownership of the situation, putting the blame on himself. That's what you want to see from a leader, especially with a young guy like Michael Porter Jr. Facundo Campazzo is a veteran in Europe, but he is in his first year in the NBA. So it's nice to see him take ownership of that situation. And then, of course, he tweeted out the angle later that he sees of everyone at the three-point line. I mean, better to learn the lesson now in the regular season than the playoffs, right, Megan?
That's for sure. For sure. The angle was what got me. That's what it did. The angle did it for me.
What do you have for us?
So for myself, I have something that we haven't seen in a couple of years since going back to RJ Barrett and Shimisi too. When you look at, you know, McDonald's All-Americans, Caleb Houston out of, you know, Mississauga getting named to the men's side for high school boys on the American All, or the McDonald's All-American, excuse me. I think that's a great honor and, you know, continues to rep for Canada.
Burger boy. I like that. And he's going to Michigan. Don't forget that.
Yeah.
No, guys, this week I was just excited to see, you know, Shai Gilgeous-Alexander dropping 42 against the San Antonio Spurs. And I think it might have been a bit emotional for me because I had some time to spend with him in the offseason during his workouts. And, you know, I was just a pylon. He was dragging me all over the place. But no, I think, you know, just to see his improvements year after year and just, to, you know, how tirelessly he hones his craft. I'm just impressed and I'm happy for the kid. I just want to continue to see him grow. I think, you know, the biggest knock on him has always been his shooting, or consistent shooting rather. And guess what? He's shooting 42% from 3. So, you know, I just want to continue to see him grow, and I'm ecstatic to see what's going on with that team.
Joining us now, we have a very special guest, commissioner and CEO of the Canadian Elite Basketball League, Mike Morreale, also former 12-year CFL veteran and 2-time Grey Cup champion. Mike, thanks for joining us.
Oh, my pleasure. Thanks, guys.
Mike, obviously no one had the 2020 that anyone wanted, but looking back, I think the CEBL can take pride in executing a successful, safe season. What are maybe some of the lessons that you can take from that, carry into 2021 to have another successful season and build on that?
We were able to pull off something last year that was, you know, it turned out to be a little bit of magic for us. Obviously, when faced with the situation at hand in about the middle of March of last year, you know, we spent about the first week thinking, hey, well, you know, May's around the corner and, you know, we got some time, everything will be cleared up and we're ready to, we'll be good to go. And little did we know. So we really kind of jumped right into what was important. And important to us was getting players back on the court, getting their buy-in, of course, because they're our biggest asset, but trying to return or at least extend the great season we had ended off with in 2019. crowning a champion in Saskatchewan in their hometown, and then being able to sign our multi-year partnership with CBC, add a team in Ottawa, add 75 new players, and we had all this great momentum going for us. So it was incredibly important to return, and to return in a safe way, of course, and to mobilize and get everyone together to work towards the common goal, which thankfully we were able to do. And we look to do somewhat similar in 2021, but to move away from the bubble concept and to get right into our markets and continue the success that we've had.
Mike, when you look at the league and the product that you put on the floor, you look at players, Junior Cadogan, Adika Peter McNeely, and many others. Looking at this pipeline, especially with regards to the senior men's national team, utilizing some of these players, most recently with the America Cup, how do you see the pipeline with the CBL and promoting Canadian talent that can be used if we see FIBA continue with these different qualifiers throughout the entire year when, you know, NBA guys may or may not be available or guys overseas may or may not be available? How do you look at utilizing the CBL in that pipeline?
Well, I think we've always wanted to be part of the pipeline. I think we're positioned perfectly to do that. You've seen from the America Cup just recently, we had 10 or 11 players that at one point played in the CBL, and we've only been around a couple of years. So it goes to show you the type of talent, certainly national talent we have is tremendous. And we are only scratching the surface. We are going to be a destination for many, many years to come for not only players that are currently overseas that want to come back and start building their brands at home and showcasing their talents and playing for Team Canada, but also the next generation of players that are in youth sports or Canadian college or NCAA. You know, the spring and summer scheduling that we have just positions us perfectly for those younger players to learn the FIBA game before they go off to play professionally overseas. They play pro right in their own backyard to attract more, you know, Canadian players that have been around for quite a long time and bring them back home and showcase them. So, you know, being able to have that North American presence and know right now that we're the best FIBA league in Canada, we're the best FIBA league in North America, we're the best FIBA league that plays during the spring and summer, and our goal is to be a top five, top five FIBA league in the world one day.
I'm going to put you on the spot quick because you and I have had a lot of conversations, and I've seen you at your worst when you're putting this thing together. Last year, I've seen you on the floor, you know, clutching your head with migraines, and you know what really went into that, because you really didn't get the go ahead until maybe 5 minutes before that first tip off in the summer series.
That's the kind of the unwritten story. Javon saw me with my migraines like a few days before when he's prepping for the teams for CBC. And the story, the journey to get from the middle of March of 2020 to tip off on July 25th of 2020, and the amount of work that went into public health and different levels of government and touch points along the way to get the approval. I'll correct you a bit. It wasn't 5 minutes. It was more like about 55 minutes, but it was within the hour before we were going to tip off that we didn't know because of some things that went wrong on the other side and miscommunication that we were going to be able to play that day. And just before tip off, we found out, but leading up to that, as Javon will attest, it was craziness.
Mike, when you see, you know, what you've done with the league over the last couple of years, and I'm going to do this because it's what I do and he loves me for it. I'm going to put Javon on the spot. When you see him going from player to covering the league and now a general manager of a team, is that something, you know, sideways of the players promoting them and the talent that there is in the league? Do you also look at what you're doing with front offices and folks surrounding the league as well too?
Oh, absolutely. It is a total, you know, well-rounded look. So we just don't provide opportunities for coaches and players and trainers. It's support staff, it's broadcasters, it's timekeepers, it's statisticians, it's officials, it's executives. It's really endless. It's that whole ecosystem I told you about. When I look at Javon, the one thing that impressed me most about Javon, and I'll tell him now, I don't want to get him too excited. He's already bigger than me. I don't want to make him any bigger than necessary. But, you know, there's a guy that, you know, retired around the same time in life that I did. I retired when I was 36. I had a long career, but then you start entering into the workplace and you're a middle-aged, you know, 30-something-year-old guy competing against people in their young 20s that just are finishing school and they've got all these degrees and they're young and hungry and they're cheaper and they're excited. So you have to take all the lessons you learned from what you learned in sport, and you have to kind of recreate yourself. And Javon did that from a broadcast side. And the one thing that really caught my attention with Javon is that after that first game that he did on CBC, he was like frustrated with his performance. And I thought he did a great job. I also thought he could improve. And I told him, listen, you're the expert. They're going to listen to you. And he took that advice and he got better and he got better and he got better. But more importantly than that, he understands the journey. He knows what it's like to be that kid growing up, learning the game, going through grassroots, taking a chance, going to the US, going international, playing for your team. And I think he really understands what the CBL stands for more than just the outer look at it. It's deeper than that. It's more important than that. So there's a lot. It's not just Javon Shepherd that's like that. There's other people cast across all of our teams. And as we grow, we keep adding pieces that make us better. Javon makes us better. And all the other people we've added make us better. And that's what we want to continue to do as we go forward.
Mike, I just want to thank you for your time. And on behalf of North Courts, just wish you all the best for the 2021 season.
Awesome. Well, I think what you guys are doing is awesome. Keep it up. Keep pumping the tires of Canadian basketball. We're going to bring this thing to new heights.
This week's Starting Five is all about coaches. We're going to shout out some of the greatest coaches that we've had here in this country. And looking at it off the top, we've got some names that are in common with each other. Javon, why don't you give us a couple of those names that maybe aren't the same?
So I'm going to go with Lisa Tomaitis, Carolyn Savoy, Rory Rana. I'm going to go with, let me take a look at my list here. Gordy Herbert, who many people probably aren't familiar with, a coach in Europe for some time, a coach of mine, but he's coached at, you know, all levels, Europe, coaching national team, and he's coaching the NBA as well. So, you know, that goes without saying. And lastly, Jay Triano. I think he's been a pioneer with, you know, where the development and coaching goes. We speak a lot about the players, but without coaches to provide the knowledge base and support for these players, we're not going to see the players that we see today. So I think, you know, the fact that he was one of the first Canadian, or is the first Canadian head coach in the NBA, to coach in the NBA, is something special.
Megan, how about you?
Yeah, so like Javon, I have Lisa Tomaitis, Jay Triano, Roy Rana, shout out to the Ryerson faithful. And I probably couldn't make a list and not include my college coach in Denise Perrier, because she would put me on the line and I don't want to run suicides in my 30s. So I had to put her on because I know the damage that she can do to me. The big one that I put on there was McMaster's very own Teresa Burns. She's been at MAC since 1992. She's won 5 OUA championships, 2019 national title, in the first one in the program's history, 3 OUA coach of the years, and 1 CIS coach of the year. So that's, I mean, her resume speaks for itself, and she's been there since 92, as I mentioned, and she's coached 2 of my childhood best friends, which is kind of crazy. And that's where I got my start in broadcasting, was at McMaster. So I couldn't have a list without her on it. And honorable mention to AJ Sharma, who's the women's coach at Humber as well too.
Yeah, I got to quickly shout out Dave Smart. I mean, what he's done with the Carlton Ravens, that program just winning national title after national title. You can't ignore that. And of course, Roy Rana getting it done. Sacramento Kings, they got that brown representation. Vivek Ranadive as an owner. You got Roy Rana as an assistant coach. And so hopefully they can keep that going. That's going to wrap it up for this episode of North Courts. Thank you so much for joining us. Don't forget to hit that like and subscribe button. And we'll catch you in 2 weeks.